So everybody knows what season it is, right? Come on, it's the first day of the season.
Baseball!
America's pastime. America. Baseball. But the problem with baseball is it's kind of hard, actually. I tried this. I'm used to, like, fighting and wrestling, so I dip my knee, right? Out of habit, anytime I twist. So Shayna had this great idea, because she's patient and loving and sweet. She's like, I can be as patient as I need to be to teach you baseball. She's like, okay, so you swing this bat thing. I got the swing thing down. It goes from right to left, not left to right. I got it. But then I went like this. And she goes, you just dropped your knee again. And she tried for, it was probably an hour before she finally goes, you're not very good at baseball, are you? And I was thinking, I was like, well, you know, baseball's just too hard. You know, and instead of fixing me, let's fix baseball. Because I don't know if it's because you posted about purple ponies, but it's just the color purple is awesome. But they've started a new sport, right? A better sport than baseball. It's called T-ball. It's brand new. Like, you have a stick and you put a ball on the stick, and so you don't have to actually figure out how to hit it. You can just, generally, it stays in place. And if you know you dip, you just start over again. And all you have to do is you take the wooden bat, I think this is plastic, you just hit it. Even that, I failed at. Okay. But the idea is, why make me better, right? Why don't we just make baseball easier? Today we're going to talk about something. We're going to talk about Christianity. And in Christianity, a lot of the times that's exactly what we've done. We said, Christianity is hard. Instead of making me better, let's make Christianity easier. Instead of saying, hey, you know, you just need to learn to hit the bat to the ball. Don't drop your knee. Figure it out. We say, well, why don't we just add a T? That would help. And, you know, once we had a T in Christianity, and then it'd be easier than someone actually throwing a ball at you as fast as they throw it at you. Remove the fear factor, too. And then at that point, we could have Christianity that was easy. And that's what we're talking about today. 2 Corinthians, chapter 6, starting in verse 1. And working together with him. We also urge you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, at the acceptable time I listened to you, and on the day of salvation I helped you. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Giving no cause for offense in anything, so that the ministry will not be discredited. But in everything, committing ourselves as servants of God, in much endurance, in affliction, in hardships, in distresses, in beatings, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in sleeplessness, in hunger, in purity, in knowledge, in patience, in kindness, in the Holy Spirit, in genuine love, in the word of truth, in the power of God, by the weapons of righteousness, for the right hand and the left, by the glory and dishonor, by evil report and good report, regarded as deceivers and yet true, as unknown yet well known, as dying yet behold we live, as punished yet not put to death. The problem with Christianity is too often we've said that it needs to be easier. And it makes sense. We've got this concept that we really want to drag people to heaven with us. We do. We want everybody to get to heaven. We do. We want everybody to come to knowledge. We want everybody to realize today is the acceptable hour. We want everybody to figure out that God has called us to salvation and we want them to receive it. And the temptation is this. Don't challenge them with something hard when I can make Christianity easy. And it reminds me of a simple verse that I hate. Do everything without grumbling or complaining. I think it's probably the hardest verse in the Bible for me. Because you think about it, you get up in the morning and it's cold. I hate cold. Okay, what's the step? I'm gonna start complaining. Then I get in there and the car takes too long to warm up. Second step, I want to complain. And that one little phrase helps me with my Christianity more than anything. Because it fits in with this. Christianity should be hard. And God says not to grumble or complain because guess what? It is hard. And real Christianity isn't like T-ball. I don't go to a T-ball match and go, this is the greatest game ever. I don't go to a baseball game either, but still. Some of you do. Some of you are like, I'm going to go see a good baseball game. And you're like, I'm going to go watch the T-ball field because that is some epic baseball. No, what you do is you go, I want to go see the major leagues. I want to go see the big game, whatever the big game is called. Huh? Super Bowl? Okay, Super Bowl? Give me a hint.
That's how much I know about.
Okay, but they have their big game, and the thing is, when we talk about it, we want to see good baseball. People want to see the best of the best playing. It's the World Series, I think.
Yes?
Okay, thank you. Appreciate your helping me. I was standing up here alone, you don't need to help me. Mean church. But that is the idea. The idea is this. People need to see real Christianity. And it makes sense to try to help this one person by going, well, let's soften Christianity. But what happens when I do? I get Christians who look no different than the world around us. And so guess what? Those around us see no difference. And that first generation, to get them all in there is good. But when they're trying to reach others, it's like, well, don't we have somebody for that? I mean, all I want you to do is accept Christ and live for Him and, you know, you're good. Let's keep it simple. Let's keep it easy. And that's where we end. But did you know that the Great Commission ends with this crazy phrase? Go make disciples. Well, I mean, I'm all about preaching and teaching you about Jesus, but making disciples is not fun. It's like teaching somebody how to swing a bat. It takes time. But making disciples is where we usually stop. We say, there's somebody in the church whose job that is. I don't know if we're going to blame the elders, the deacons, or the loudmouth up front. But we're going to blame somebody. And we're going to say, their job is making disciples. And we're not going to say, my job is making disciples. We're going to say, my job is to come here and do the most active participation I need to do. Sit here and listen. Take the communion on time. You know, don't spill or anything. Don't make it too difficult here. And we act like that is our Christianity. And our Christianity is making disciples. And these things happen. Hardship, distress, affliction. And if you do it loud enough, you're going to get in trouble. And if you actually do these things, then you know what? There's still that persecution that Jesus promises you. He says, they persecuted me, they will persecute you. Not they could, they might. There's a chance. He says, they will. And the thing is, if that is what Jesus says, we ought not to call him a liar. And if we're not getting some form of persecution, some, whether that's just people talking behind our back, whether that's someone actually calling us out, whether that's us losing a position, losing pride, losing those things, it still is more than just, you know, I'm a Christian, it makes no difference. Because when we live out Christianity, we're guaranteed hardships. And when we're not experiencing hardships, we're not experiencing Christianity. We're experiencing a weaker form that is not what God intended. But he continues with this in verse 10. As sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing, but possessing all things. Our mouth has spoken freely to you, O Corinthians. Our heart is open wide. You are not restrained by us, but you are restrained in your own affections. Now in a like exchange, I speak as to children, open wide to us also. Do not be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness and lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Or what harmony has Christ with Belial? Or what has a believer in common with an unbeliever? Or what agreement has the temple of God with idols. For we are the temple of the living God. Just as God said, I will dwell in them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from their midst and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch what is unclean, and I will welcome you. And I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Great phrase, and we love to say it. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Right? And it sounds good, and we put them on bumper stickers. You know, a follower of Jesus, I got a fish on there, it says something in the middle, I don't know those letters. Right? And we get, we'll put it on our bumper sticker. And we're like, oh, it's great to be a child of God, it's great to be the temple of the Holy Spirit. I think we're forgetting Jesus. I think we're forgetting that Jesus came to this earth and he experienced what it was like to represent God. It ended real well for him, if you haven't read the story yet. Right? They killed him. I mean, just so you know, this is new to some of you. At the end of Christ's life, what do? They kill him. He lives for God. He represents God. He embodies the Holy Spirit. And they kill him. Welcome to Real Christianity 101. To be the representative of God is to be like Christ. To be the temple of God is to say that you need to be separated. Is to say that I need to be different. In a world of darkness, I need to be that light he talks about. In a world of unrighteousness, I need to be righteousness. And saying that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit should scare us as much as anything. It's so loving that God trusts us with this mighty power, this mighty opportunity, this mighty calling. But it should humble us. Because we know we're not like the temple. We know we're not like the temple of God. When they made it, they made sure every stitch was perfect. The thing was made with gold, costly stones. The thing was purple. Everybody knows purple is the best. And God designed everything perfectly. It had to be so many cubits. Everything had to be an exact measurement. Everything had to be embroidered perfectly. You carve fruit into the pillars just to make sure this place was beautiful. And that's what God replaced. God replaced that with you and me. And when we make Christianity something less than it is, we're telling them, hey, go look at that temple. And we're just pointing to some shack at the end of the road. And it's not that we will be as perfect as the temple. But it's that when people don't see us trying to live out Christianity, we get what we get today. Who wants to be a Christian? They're all hypocrites. Why would I go to church? Do you know what they do? And it's not so much that we have sin in our lives, it's that some of us are complacent. And we think that coming to church is our job. Taking communion, that's what we do. And we forget that Christianity says, give me your life. What does it begin with? Hate your mother, your father, your brother, sister. You got a friend? You better hate them in comparison to Jesus. And if we leave here having done Christianity, then everybody's going to look at the temple and go, what kind of temple is that? And be like, this is God's temple. And they'll be like, what kind of God is that? What kind of God is it who doesn't put forth any effort? What kind of God is it who doesn't stop to help someone? What kind of God who lives out his faith and hides in a building? And real Christianity is hard. Because it doesn't talk about Sunday morning. Acts is very clear when the church met together. Daily, from house to house. then write it. And giving completely of themselves. So what we're left with is this, a challenge. And this is more of a fitting sermon for a challenge than an invitation. The challenge is that there is nothing that you're going to do here that will be shining God's light as bright as you going to the store in 5 minutes. Nothing will be shining as bright as you going to work Monday morning. Nothing is going to give you the opportunity to say, this is what God looks like more than when you're out in darkness. And you're not mixed with the darkness. You are contrasting the darkness. You're the light in the middle of the darkness. When we're all in here just shining at each other, it's not that bright. But when we, as individuals, go out into our world and shine in darkness, real Christianity happens, and people look at us and say, I wonder what kind of God has that kind of temple. People would travel for hours and hours to get to the temple of God, and that was the way it was. And you had to go twice a year because you wanted to be close to God. And we are that temple. And when people see us, do they go, I want to know more about that God that that kind of temple made? And we can. Not by being perfect, but by putting forth a life. And hating our own life enough to say that our whole life belongs to God. Whether that's family, whether that's self, no matter what that is. Are we going to be a temple that God will say, hey, I'm going to go see that game? Or are we going to say, we're going to make Christianity like T-ball? And everybody's going to watch the Super Bowl of T-ball. Let's say if they go to the Super Bowl of Christianity. The Super Bowl of people actually being the temple of God. The World Series of this is what God's temple is now. We like to end with an invitation. It's not a perfect fit for this. And it's Acts 2. Starting in verse 37. And I know we've heard it. And I know we've heard it. But the way they responded is so important to us today. We always look straight to baptism, just skip over the very first part. Acts 2:37. Now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Today we offer that invitation. If there is somebody who hasn't responded to Christ, Christ's death, Christ being Lord, believing that Jesus is Lord, confessing Jesus as Lord, so that we follow him. Repenting of our sins, knowing that he deserves better than we offer. Being baptized into him, dying to ourselves so that we can live for him. And then, finally, living for him. Sunday. And onward. If there's anybody who needs to respond to that today, or anybody who needs prayers, or anybody who wishes to submit to the eldership here, we ask you to come now as we stand and as we sing.